This year, we mark the centenary of the founding of Na Féin Éireann by Constance Markovich and Bulmer Hobson. They named their organisation after and in honour of Finn McCool's warrior poets of Irish folklore. The ancient Fianna were renowned not only for their prowess as warriors, but also renowned for their talents in art and poetry, their guile, their love of humour and of song. They were noble through their actions and through their deeds, and not by birthright or by title. It was certainly quite a legacy for the young people of Fianna Éireann to uphold in 1909 and since, but uphold it they did. Uphold it they did in the Easter Rising, in the Tan War, in the Civil War, and in the most recent IRA campaign. They conducted themselves with a kind of courage and steadfastness for which their legendary namesakes are often famed in the annals of Irish mythology. Many of them lost their lives, others spent young lives in prison cell. And young people indeed have been to the forefront throughout periods of struggle, not motivated by hatred or by personal gain, but motivated by the fact that they saw great wrongs and wanted to put them right. And that involvement is not something that needs to be consigned to the pages of history. Today, we also have a place at the forefront of the struggle for young people, and I would appeal to young people to take that up. And I want to pay tribute to the new generation of young people, young Republicans. We see the same steadfast, the same enthusiasm, the same commitment in the young people in Ogre Sinn Féin, in the Sinn Féin Common, in the colleges. Pay tribute to all of you young Republicans today. Bobby Sands was just 19 when he went to jail for the first time. At the age of 25, he was sentenced again, never to see freedom. Like the Fianna of the folklore, the Fianna of the past century, Bobby Sands and his comrades in Loncash and in Armagh Jail, they were little more than children when they took on the might of their oppressor. Very young and yet very active. 5 years they endured the horrors of the blanket and no-wash protests. They withstood the torture and the degradation of a system that sought to crush the freedom struggle by brutalising and trying to crush young men and young women. But it was the system itself that ultimately perished in the tombs of Loncash. It was Britain's attempts to demonise, to criminalise and to defeat our struggle that today lie buried in the rubble of Loncash. Last month, the Sunday Times newspaper tried to call into question the Republican leadership's handling of the hunger strike with lurid and misleading headlines in the paper when they published some British documents which had been released under the Freedom of Information Act. And yet, when you read even the British documents that they published, they actually corroborate, these documents corroborate the account of what happened at the time by Brendan McFarlane, by the surviving hunger strikers, by Sinn Féin, and indeed by the Irish Commission for Justice and Peace. There were negotiations, there was an offer, in fact a number of different offers, but as the British refused to sign anything or give a public commitment to move before the hunger strike ended, there was no deal. Due to the way that the British had handled the end of the first hunger strike, the hunger strikers wouldn't end their fast without some form of public commitment. And indeed the timeline published by the Bobby Sands Trust shows that the British government refused to meet the hunger strikers and to stand over their offer. In song and poetry and film, art, commemoration, the 1918 hunger strikers live on and they continue to inspire a new generation of Republicans. And what of Margaret Thatcher? Is she remembered for bravery and sacrifice? Is she remembered for a contribution to freedom or liberty? Does her memory inspire young generations here and throughout the world? I think not. She will be remembered for her intransigence, brutality, and her absolute refusal to act honestly or honourably. The hunger strike, on the other hand, it's regarded already as a watershed in Irish history, and I have no doubt that in the fullness of time it will be seen as a pivotal moment in our long march to freedom. The struggle and the sacrifice of Bobby Sands and of his comrades continues to sustain Republicans today the length and breadth of Ireland. What has changed is the context and the means by which that struggle is now carried on. New ways for a new time that Republicans have managed to bring about. We've come a great distance. We've changed relationships on the island of Ireland. We've changed them forever. We've opened up a peaceful and democratic path to a united Ireland. We've ended the old ways of the Orange State, and there's absolutely no way now of going back to the old days of domination. Those days are gone. So I'd appeal to young Republicans not to be swayed by the rhetoric of mitre groups who seem intent on pursuing war for war's sake. Because armed struggle is not a philosophy or an ideology in itself. It's a decision of last resort and something that can only be justified when there's no other avenue. It has to have a moral basis. It has to be understood and supported by a large number of people who are the oppressed. And that's a point, that latest point was one that was pointed out and dealt directly with by Bobby Sands when he was reflecting on his life as an IRA volunteer. The people stood by us, he wrote. The people not only opened the doors of their homes to lend us a hand, but they opened their hearts to us. I learnt that without the people we could not survive, and I knew that I owed them everything. So while I accept that there are some unionists, and even some who aspire to Irish unity, that have difficulty where we are, it's absolutely clear that the popular will is to move forward. The reality is that that's what people want. And the reality is that our struggle is the only struggle that's going to deliver Irish unity and freedom. And I would urge everyone to get involved. Again, as Bobby Sands said, everyone, Republican or otherwise, has their own particular part to play. And no part is too great or too small, no one too young or too old to do something. Tamij Dangana, Nis Dangana Nishna Ryu, Konpublik Nahir in the Winchamach, Neuromij Ryu Kokongri, the Lana Sirsha. Agasami Duklana Taroin, Agas May Erin Torchfuhu. The union has been hollowed out, an increasingly confident nationalist and republican community are taking co-ownership of every aspect of life across this island. But if we're ever to pay a fitting tribute to Bobby Sands, to his comrades, to the Fianna, and to all those sacrificed so much for Irish freedom, then we have to build on that progress and we have to complete the task at hand. And I want to say that today, particularly in the presence of family of those in the Fianna and in all the other Republican organisations who've given so much to bring our struggle forward. In the coming weeks, there are a number of elections that are taking place, European elections across Ireland, local government elections in the 26 counties. There's also a number of ongoing justice and equality campaigns. And both here and abroad, Sinn Féin are building a vibrant and dynamic campaign for a united Ireland. There'll be a number of major conferences in the United States later this year, some in Britain next year. And that national dialogue that's kick-starting this campaign has already begun. So as you take to the campaign trail, to the streets of our towns, to the highways and byways of our countryside, take with you the message that conditions for achieving united Ireland are stronger now than they've been for generations. And I know that the grind of daily work and organising and building and campaigning can be challenging. And indeed, at times, it's hard to see where the piece that you're working on fits into the bigger picture. But that's not how Bobby Sands saw it. Bobby Sands understood better and earlier than most of us the critical importance of campaigning and working on behalf of people. He threw himself into his community activism after he was released from his first prison sentence, community activism in Twinbrook, bringing to his task all the legendary energy and enthusiasm that he had. When he was knocking on the doors in Twinbrook and agitating and organising on behalf of people, he was creating the template for the later Sinn Féin activists of today. So when you take the campaign trail, when we take to the campaign trail, let us apply ourselves to the work of struggle and always remember whose example we are following. Very much.